How to treat me like a queen.
My name is Oluwate Obilobabao. Yes, yes, I know, that's like a mouthful, like 500 syllables. But just forgive me. Welcome, welcome to Helium Health Podcast. And this is our International Women's Day session, right? And that's happening in a couple of days. So, woo! And I have someone in the house. Someone I love, actually. I love her. Guess what? So I love her because, you know, something happens to me at the end of every month. No, not my period. Please. Something happens at the end of every month, an alert that, you know, that alert, that sound, that melodious sound that you like to hear. Yeah. So this person in the house is responsible for that. Her name is Ijeoma. Ijeoma, I love you. Do you know I love you?
Because I pee your
salary. I have other reasons. And they will get to find out. Okay. They will get to find out. So many reasons. A plethora of reasons, Ijeoma. Welcome. So, you know, interesting about you, Ijeoma. Something interesting. You studied mechanical engineering in school. And now you're here. You're in tech, right? And that's cool. But you're like in human resources. Yeah. So Ijeoma is our head of human resources, by the way. So, you know, if you ask me, Toby, I studied petroleum and gas engineering, right? And you ask me, how did you get here? I'll probably answer you by saying, well, two heartbreaks from two companies that I loved. And then, you know, maybe one depressive episode. And then self-realization that I got here. But what's your story? Is it a good one? Is it a bad one? How did you get here?
So I'll answer my question. And I'll also ask you another question about... because probably your perspective will also add to it. How did I get here? Mechanical engineering.
Yeah.
Well, at least going to school, all through school, I never, ever imagined I would end up in HR. Maybe because of the perception of HR. Like, everybody I know about HR room, human resources. In fact, the funny thing is, every time I ask people, why do you want to be in HR? They always tell me, because I love people. And I'm like, huh? If only you knew, right? You don't need to love people to be in HR. Everybody should love people to do the jobs they do, as long as you're managing people.
Yeah.
Right? But how did I end up here? Well, I think it was because of what I always wanted to do, which was to design.
Yeah. Right?
That was why I went into engineering in the first place. I wanted to be able to design things. I wanted to design systems. I just wanted to design things that work.
Mm-hmm.
And so maybe at some point in school, I realized, and I think I'm going to partly blame the Nigerian education sector, right?
Okay.
At some point in school, I realized that, okay, the way I am studying engineering, I don't think I'm being fully prepped to be able to design mechanical engineering systems.
Yeah.
Who knows, maybe if I'd studied somewhere abroad where there were more pragmatic approaches to engineering and engineering theories, I definitely would have ended up, because I loved doing it. All my IT attachment I spent in... one engineering workshop or the other. Like, at my 400 level, I was really working on my car at home. My dad's car.
Okay.
My dad bought me this big toolbox and I was very happy to say, that's my daughter. She said, my car engineer.
I can't imagine.
But then I realized that most of the opportunities, I'm not saying there were no opportunities in Nigeria, but most of the opportunities were really about the shallow part of engineering, right? The best you could get was maintenance and everything. And it really wasn't going to appeal to me. I wouldn't have been satisfied.
Yeah.
So sometime, I think, in 300 level, I started understanding the concepts of consulting. So that was when I started getting interested in consulting. Management consulting, to be precise. And consultants really design organizational systems that help, that make sure the organizations work. So that was where I just decided to pivot my aspirations. So my first job was in Kia, but the moment I got the opportunity to work in consulting, I didn't even blink.
I see.
So I moved to Philips Consulting, and I was in the management consulting arm of Philips Consulting, and yeah, that was where my... And from there, I went into talent management, which really is like consulting, but in the company, and then here I am in HR. Yeah, so the thing is, HR is one of the natural jobs that people in MC really... get to do, and I still have that love for consulting. Like, really, I use that as my approach to most of the stuff I do on a daily basis. So yeah, that's how I ended up here.
That's interesting, actually, Gemma. Thank you for that. I mean, I see a flow here. Life didn't just happen to you like some of us. I mean, I'm glad. I mean, I'm grateful.
You guys
have here,
to ask you a question.
Yes. Hit me.
And my question really is, if you were to get an opportunity in petroleum engineering, will you go back?
No. I mean, I'm not even going to take a second to think about it, no. I mean, if you remember, I said self-realization happened, and I realized, you know what, this is what I should be doing, right? Mm-hmm. I had to have some experiences, but yeah, I'm grateful for them, and I'm happy to be here. You know, yeah, so if you know Ijeoma brings a twist to HR. I mean, she's intelligent about what she does. Yeah.
I'm a hype woman.
There's this anxiety when you're joining a new company. You're like, how's it going to be like? And then you meet the head of HR and you're like, whoa. Like, she knows everything, right? Yeah, and I mean, I was so excited when I met her. So, Ijeoma, I think I know, like, I've spent a couple of months with you, and I see that you're intentional about trying to create, like, an equitable system for, you know, in the workplace, more inclusive workplace. Mm-hmm. And I think I want to have like a little bit of, you know, insight into what you're doing, right? Like what kind of stereotypes are you trying to kick against? What are you challenging? What biases are you challenging?
Well, what biases am I challenging? Biases that, you know, when we really look at it, there's a lot of buzzwords around things like diversity.
Yeah.
Challenging and bias and all of that. And the thing with buzzwords is sometimes it deceives people to think that they are actually making progress and doing stuff and they're really not doing it.
Mm-hmm.
But I approach diversity and challenging stereotypes from the angle that you really need to be able to change systems that don't work within your company.
Again, like I said, it's
the way I like to approach things. And in fact, I like to design things that actually work. Right, not design things that can tick boxes to say, okay, did you get your diversity?
Yeah, you know.
Right, and so my approach with diversity is, I believe diversity actually works. What do I mean? I believe that, and there are a lot of studies that really support it, to show that companies that have a diverse workforce really perform better. I think that any company that wants to be successful, especially if the people that you are servicing are a diverse country, a diverse nation.
Yeah.
You want to have diversity of ideas. You cannot get diversity of ideas where you have homogeneous people. If you have people, different set of people all thinking the same way,
correct,
they are most likely going to approach and they're going to give you solutions that all really look alike and sound alike. How do you really have creativity in a place like that?
Mm-hmm.
How do you
mm-hmm.
really have
mm-hmm.
innovation in a place like that? You might be thinking you're innovating. You might be thinking you're creative, but really, when you really look at the profiles of companies, the profiles of, you know, and that's the thing. The thing about results is they speak for themselves. They don't lie.
Correct.
When you see some
correct.
Things, when you see creatives and you see all of those things that look beautiful and work, and you go and look at the life of the person, you see that this person has had some kind of experience that is different from the status quo and stereotype. So that's my approach to it. Because I understand the benefits of things like that, it helps to be particular about, you know what, create, and in all the different avenues that people come into the company and people are developed within the company, create systems that encourage diversity of ideas, create systems that encourage having diverse people. People naturally, let's be honest, like, people are more comfortable with people who look and sound like them.
Correct.
So you need to have people ask the right questions. Why do you really want this person?
Is it because
and the thing with diversity is it's there are many demographics you can use to define it. You can use gender, you can use race. If I come to Nigeria, you can even use tribe, right, to define it. In a much larger world, you can use sexual orientation and things like that. People always naturally like their people. Right, it's the reason why if we were to go to Iran, for example, and I saw you, the way I react to you, people like their people. So you just have to have people asking the right questions to say, why are you really doing this? Why are you really taking this decision to hire this person? Okay, let's take a look at this other person. Let's talk. It's okay to have, and I don't think it's such a difficult thing to achieve in Helium, maybe because we are largely made up of a young workforce.
Mm.
And I think this generation is more open to, we're not as tribal, we're not as racist. I think we're more open, so it's easier, right, for people to be able to see their own bias when it's identified to them, things like that. So I won't say at Helium it has been an uphill battle, right? It's just for you to always ask the questions or challenge when you see people taking some certain decisions. Say, why are you really doing that? And one of the quickest examples I can use is during recruitment, right? When we are having interviews and all of that, those are part of things I just like to take notice of, to see how many people, what kinds of people, what kinds of experiences and backgrounds these people come from. Who says, let me give an example, who says somebody selling in growth team must be in the medical field? I've had that kind of argument before. Say, we want somebody, who says, right, what if you look at somebody who knows how to sell but is coming from this particular field? They might come in with their own experience on how to deal with human beings and clients in that field and things. So
I see you mentioned the affinity bias, actually, where, you know, you tend towards those that remind you of yourself, you know, studies show that people that are mentored in the workplace do better, you know, grow faster than those that are not mentored. And if you're only mentoring people that remind you of yourself, then you see that we have to deal with such biases, right? And then there's also the performance bias. I mean, there's some interesting things. I have my personal experiences of, you know, stuff that address the you know, this bias that is deep-rooted, you know, that are settled in the recesses of our being, that you just know that this person, oh my God. Let me give you an example. So in my past life, my former life, like someone used to say, I used to be like the only girl in my team, right? So just typically everybody just thinks, okay, when there's birthday, Toby, organize food. Toby, yeah. Toby. I might be the one with the highest workload.
So annoying.
I mean, just tell me about it. But I mean, women are expected to just be what? Just that is our expertise.
That is one of the most annoying things ever. And my natural response to things like that is why?
Why?
And by the time you ask somebody why, it will shock you. Like, they're just showing their natural, like I
correct.
Said.
It's deep-rooted,
The thing about buzzwords, especially buzzwords that are supposed to portray things around political correctness, right? I think this generation is doing better.
Yeah.
It's doing better, but we are not there yet.
Yeah.
We're doing better, but there's also something I've noticed where sometimes we say the right words, but when I really interact with you and you show your real self, those right words you are saying are not...
It's just talk. Yeah.
But I found out that one of the best ways to really answer and approach people like that is to just ask them why.
Mm-hmm.
I've had that, like, even from school. You don't even want to know how annoying it is. Like, sure, you organize the food. I'm like, why?
Why?
Like,
you don't even have to be aggressive about it.
No, you just
get them, because it gets them to rethink their position.
You.
Yeah.
And just ask why.
Mm-hmm.
And by the time they find out that they are about to say something like, because
silly.
You are
deep. You know, they're like, okay. And it's nice when you have a man actually saying why. Like, I just always imagine how it would have been if somebody on my team, a guy, just, why does it have to be Toby this time?
You know, so that is one funny thought I have about International Women's Day celebration.
Hmm.
Or a lot of women type of organizations that are centered on women.
Yeah.
And things. They are actually really fantastic. They're doing a great job. But how do I say this now? So let me use International Women's Day as an example. We are celebrating women.
Yeah.
But the funny thing I realize is most times it's women celebrating women. But people need to understand that the world is 50-50.
Correct.
We also have 50% of men.
Yeah.
And my question is, what are these men saying about women? The focus of the day should be celebrating women,
yes,
no doubt.
Yeah.
But my own is, the approach to it must include both genders, because people need to understand that 50% of the population, what is happening to them affects 100% of the population. So
correct.
The other 50% cannot afford to ignore a whole 50%.
Exactly.
So
yes,
even in celebrating Women's Day and things like that, yes, the focus is always women. The focus should be women. I'm not saying you should not focus on women.
Mm-hmm.
What I'm about to suggest, maybe if anybody thinks it's going to take focus of the women, maybe we can have another day called International Women's Day celebrated by men.
By men, you know.
But it's important that things like International Women's Day should not be celebrated by, it should not be women celebrating women. A number of organizations I've worked in, things like that, it's always the women that come together to organize something for the women.
Yeah.
The guys, you should be in this conversation.
Yes.
sit down and hear what we are talking about, because we are talking about solving problems that affect us, but we need to understand that the people contributing to the problem is also 50% of, is also the other half. So they should
correct.
Be here hearing
correct.
These things.
Correct.
They should be here also talking about, we should be having a dialogue. We should all be involved. Don't come and slap buzzwords in my face to say, yeah.
You know.
Let's have a discussion and,
yes, yes.
and answer why
yes.
you'll be asking me to serve you meat pie. When, and why you have ladies on your team and your natural instinct is when we are planning a party, you should be, they
correct,
should be the ones
correct.
Having those conversations
correct.
Too. And it's important we involve them, and it, this thing stops looking like International Women's Day.
For women, by women, you know. Right, so I like your take on this, right? Explaining the importance of diversity in the workplace to say, right? You just, people are different, right? Man, woman, women are different, right? Men are different. So you bring that mix into it, you're creating a very, you know, a platform for creativity, productivity.
Yep.
That interesting mix, like cooking soup and putting all those ingredients into it. So yeah, think about it from that perspective.
Mm-hmm.
Think about diversity from that perspective and not just say 50% of our senior leaders must be men and 50% must be women. You know, no.
It's the benefits that you get out of
correct,
it.
Correct.
Because if you don't always look at the end, if you're not looking at the outcome,
correct.
If you're not looking at what you're trying to achieve,
correct.
You might wrongly think you've made the right move.
Yeah.
And by ticking boxes. But here's what will happen. You might not be getting the desired result. And what that will do is it will attach an emotional signature to what
exactly.
you've done. It will
exactly.
now look as if what you've done is not working. So
correct.
Why are you people disturbing me about 50
correct.
50
you see?
But if you approach diversity from there's a benefit to it,
mm-hmm.
right? So what you're really looking at is to get that benefit. So you're trying to engineer the benefits that you're
like
hoping
it.
To get
like yeah.
by including all of this mix in your workforce. And you will see it. Like, it's not something that is a buzzword. You will see those benefits, right? By the time you start hearing the kinds of, like, it, some of our meetings that we've had, you've seen how it is and the kinds of takes that different people bring. Even
yeah.
in having, I'm just using a very basic example, in having a management meeting about
mm-hmm.
outcomes for the whole company, you find out that we bring in everybody from all the different functions. I might be taking a decision and, for example, legal brings a perspective that you naturally wouldn't have thought of. So it's the same thing. People, different people bring their own different approaches, bring their own different ideas, bring different angles. You naturally won't
correct.
See, especially if you
correct.
Are brought up in a certain way. There are some
yeah.
things you would just not see. I've seen some people do some marketing ideas, and I'm like, the person that came up with this idea was a rich guy.
Mm.
Like, this thing will not
mm-hmm.
even, it will fit the natural
husband. Not male, female, just rich guy. You
rich
know.
Guy. There are some
uh-huh.
things that you see like that, you know, if this
yeah.
thing was passed through some people that see some stuff, they,
yeah.
it wouldn't have sounded so tone deaf or things like that. So that's the reason why you need to,
I get you.
Have that kind. You need to engineer diversity.
Nice. Let's take it back a bit. Let's talk a little bit about facts that we have,
mm-hmm.
right? So, you know, facts actually show, studies actually show that we girls do better in school than boys.
They will fight you.
But they are facts. The numbers show it.
They will fight
they
you.
They do better. And guess what? Even a greater percentage of girls proceed to higher education,
mm-hmm.
right? And yet we have 65% of senior leadership positions occupied
mm-hmm.
by men. I mean, I want to hear your perspective. Why do you think this is so?
Well, so let's start from the first set to say facts show girls do better.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
People have their different perspective to this. I've had this discussion with a number of people so many times. And especially if you're looking at it from, and this is now my own thoughts and opinion, especially if you're looking at it from, let's take an example of, and my thoughts and opinion from my own real life.
Yeah, experiences,
and
yeah.
observations. If you look at, let's look at secondary school, right? Let me tell you something funny I noticed, and I've spoken to a number of people that noticed the same thing. In GSS1, right, you look at, let's say there are 50 guys, 50 girls. First and second position, first to 10, you see guys and girls equally holding that position. GSS2, GSS3, SS1. By the time the boys have learned how to play.
Yeah, yeah.
They are no longer serious.
Mm-hmm.
Only some sets remain serious. So the reason why I'm saying that is, yes, facts show that women do better. But I think both guys and girls, to be honest, do better. But yes, let's still take those facts to answer the actual question you're trying to ask. And even up until entering higher education, and let me add this, up until entering entry-level positions, right?
Yeah.
You will see that you can see both guys and girls. You will see that performance-wise, guys and girls at the early stage of the organization, you will see guys and girls being promoted almost at the same rate.
Yeah.
And I'm taking an assumption where this is an organization that has had 50%. This is an organization that's had 50% of male and female entering at that level of the workforce.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
There are some occupations, and that's a different that's a different discussion. There are some occupations that naturally have more men than, let me not say naturally, but for whatever reason, have more men than women entering. So for organizations like that, the battle has already been lost. Where, so I remember when I was at Kia, I was the only lady on the shop floor.
Mm.
And we were about, I think we were about 20 engineers.
Mm.
We were two ladies at some point. One left some, so I was the only lady at some point. I guess
yeah,
I
yeah.
left. So I don't know if they found another lady to replace me. So for something like that, I was already 1 to 20.
I see.
So
mm-hmm.
there's that. So let me take a situation where we assume there's 50-50. And then we find out that as senior leadership, the 50-50 is not maintained.
Yeah.
The quickest thing that comes to mind, again, from my observation and experience, and even from my HR experience, is, I don't even want to say it's at this side of the world, because I think it happens everywhere. It's the natural order of things that happen to women. They get married, they give birth. It sounds like something so sweet and basic.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But I think that's part of the thing that happens. So when you get married, the more generic approach that people have is, if, for example, you get married and you want to relocate, it's the woman that leaves her job.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
By that, let's say you've lost 2% out of the 50%, that's dropped to 48%.
Yes, yes.
Then there's maternity,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
And guys cannot give birth. Guys cannot give birth.
True that.
But so maternity leave. So in a year of 12 months, let's say the woman is out of work, she's not working actively for 3 to 6 months.
Yeah.
And from HR, let's say you now want to promote, and your promotion policy says you need at least 9 to 12 months of work to be promoted that year.
Mm.
That drops another, let's say, 10%. It drops 10% this year.
Yeah.
It drops 10% next year. It drops 10% by the 30. And most of those women go back to work. By the time they're going back to work, their male counterparts have been promoted.
Mm.
They didn't go on maternity leave. Right? And on your first, when you look at it from a first perspective, it will be, someone will say, you see, that's not fair for women.
Yeah.
And the next question you say is, for the guys that were working, quote unquote. So this is some part of the conversation that becomes dicey and sensitive. The next part is, for the guys that were working within those 6 months that the women were not working, will you say they should not be promoted? Because so those are now how naturally we've gotten to where we are. So that's what happens most times. I've seen this thing happen so many times where they are being promoted, senior analyst, assistant manager. Then from assistant manager, maybe it's naturally aligns with their age. So let's say all of us came by 26. It takes 5 years to get to senior assistant manager. By 31, you want to start having kids and things like
mm-hmm,
that.
Mm-hmm.
So slowly like that, you begin to slow down. That's one aspect. There's the second aspect where when it gets to promotions to higher position, there is actual active bias. I've seen this one my kids eyes. Where they will be like, she say, woman, she cannot go
you
down.
Know,
well,
you know.
There is that. Let me, with my chest, accuse the older generation, because they are the ones that have seen it in the most, to say that work is too aggressive for a woman to do.
Yes.
They might in their people always say I like to do devil's advocate a lot.
Speak girl.
But let me just in their defense, because this generation, coconut head generation, doesn't want to hear this, but in their defense, right, it's how they've been raised.
Yeah.
In their mind,
yeah.
Some of them might be genuinely trying to help the woman by not giving her something
mm-hmm.
that is stressful.
Mm-hmm.
I will tell you that I know what I go through on this job, right? And then they decide not to promote me.
Yes,
women.
Yes.
Because I've had these conversations with other people. Tell me your real reason. Like,
yes.
Why? Another person, somebody has said things like, to be honest, this job, I work 20 out of 24 hours in a day.
Mm.
I don't think a woman should do that. And they are coming,
yes,
so
yes,
you
yes.
hear, they're coming from good places. So that's where you now start having issues like that. And so my own is, for me, I think that is what causes things like that. Now, how to solve it, I have ideas on how to solve it, but for me, that's what causes things like that. From It's the little, little things that reduce it 1%, 2%, from things like a woman being the one that relocates most times when they get married, to maternity leave slowing down promotion, to now active discrimination of men, maybe in their own goodwill. Like I said, let me play devil's advocate. Maybe in their goodwill or in their own beef, choosing not to promote women into positions like that, because then... fourth place, they are, do you know there are now actual cases where you can actually promote a woman to that kind of position, but she opts out because it's crazy, right? You are working 20, I kid you not, you're working 20 out of 24 hours, and you decide that you don't want that for yourself.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And the world naturally would not look down at a man, right, if he decides to go that kind of... He does the aggression. I'm a man now, my friend.
Yes, no.
Those are part of things that we are calling toxic masculinity. Now, my friend, you are a guy, you can do the work, and they look at the lady and like, what kind of work are you doing that is stressing you? So those are the little things that is dropping it 10%. Before you know it, by the time you measure it at that level, you now find...
I like these factors. I like these things that you're exposing us to. I think it's very enlightening, to be honest. When I think about maternal bias in the workplace, you know, even right from the point of interview, you just let it slip that, oh, I'll be getting married in a couple of months. They'll say, oh, then the next 10 months,
you know,
maternity leave. You know, they already start doing it for you because they believe a woman should, right? A woman should stay at home 3 months, take care of a baby. A woman
that
should...
That is where you see the active discrimination and things like that. But then again, like I said, if one of the things you put at the back of your mind is the fact that if I really truly want the best outcome for my business, I need diversity of ideas. And I'm not doing it just because I want to tick boxes, right? I actually need, because of the kind of positive outcomes that I'm hoping to get, we need to celebrate more the results that people that actively take steps towards ensuring that the workplace is
a
good place to
work
for both. If we celebrate the kind of outcomes they get, then an example I'll give is one of the solutions I think will help things like this is even what we call work, right? Like cases for cases like someone is working 20 out of 24 hours, I think be it a guy or a girl, I don't think anybody should work that crazy. Like you know, life is fickle, and you want to spend the larger part of your life enjoying different things. There's the mindset where you work so hard, and then at the later part of your life, you now enjoy. But I think for you to even bring your best to work, there needs to be that balance. There needs to be that mental. Like, let me shock you. Let me just tell guys, the reason why it's important that you need to make your workplace and your systems easier for you is because you enjoy it. Yourself, you live the baby boy life.
You know.
Why should you be working 20 out of 24 hours for the love of God? And if it's not that, the results you get is astronomically different from if you were working normal time. Do you understand?
Yeah.
Get somebody else to do the work so that you don't put up. The cost... versus the results, you don't need to overwork a human being, be it male or female. So you need to make working conditions favorable. Because to be honest, if a woman decides to opt out from a 20-hour kind of crazy job because she wants to be there for her family, it's okay. But what I'm saying is a guy too should be able to opt out. The world should not celebrate toxic masculinity, saying that no, you're a guy who does that kind of work. No, we should change those kind of outrageous, like what are you doing on the road by 4 a.m. because you've been working like that for a whole week. Like, how can you spend your whole life working like a donkey? So those are part of the things that by the time we find ourselves creating the workplace that favors in our mind, we might be doing it for women, but it is both genders that will enjoy it at the end of the day.
The
baby boy life.
I agree with you. I totally agree with you. And I think one thing I'm taking out of this is, you know, everybody ask why. Don't fight anybody, don't be aggressive, but when you see this kind of any type of bias, just ask why. It might be your superior, a subordinate. Just why did you do that? Why did you respond to her like that? Why did you respond to him like that? You know,
do you know the fun thing about asking why and bias is there's the other part of it that I call a little bit of condescend, right? In the sense that, you know, the same way you say hear people say things like, we're having a birthday party, let Toby And you're asking why.
Organized small chops.
Yes, organized small chops. It's the same way I've also seen cases where, let's say, male bosses decide to treat women different because they are softer.
I get you.
They won't
get
give
you.
Them plenty work. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, for me, that's some kind of, you're kind of being condescending. Because who told you I can't do it?
Oh, I need to stop you here. There's this particular one that is dear to my heart.
Oh, yeah.
How a senior boss will come into a room and say, Biscuit, just look at you. If that you are a girl, you should have like a mini, you know, supermarket there somewhere. And then all of us start thinking, oh, it's like that's what he likes. So then we now go and start buying biscuit and chocolate because you know what? It's an appraisal issue. They'll be saying, it's an appraisal issue, though. Because as a woman, you should just be able to. Why should I come to you and not be able to get chewing gum? So I feel like even people at that level, we need to start, you know, subtly asking them, why are you doing that? Why didn't you ask that other guy beside her?
Yeah.
I was just fresh out of school and I had that experience where they were like, Toby, if you want to, if you're that guy and be buying biscuits, see that up, Marty. Buy biscuit, buy chocolate when you're coming, put it on there. When he comes in, just...
Wow.
You get... I don't believe it's a big corporate. You really need to start asking them, like, don't do that. Don't set this thing rolling, you get. And I like how, I'm a little bit more intelligent now after speaking to you. At least I have, like, I can explain why it is that we have more people, more male in, you know, in leadership than women now. Like, and I hope everybody can now, right? And that really helps. Let me just ask you, Helium Health, how are we doing? I can answer, I'm an employee, but I want to hear from you.
So, funny enough, it's I'll say it's a little consistent with what you've seen, what you see. I think we're better. It's consistent, but we're doing better, and I think we can get there. And the reason why I'll say it's consistent is because, you know, when I was explaining part of the factors that contribute to it, not all the factors were determined by the workplace itself. There were some factors that were determined by larger society.
Correct.
For example,
correct.
Like women who marry and they're the ones who have to relocate. So some statistics, that's why I brought my book. At the junior level, we have almost 50-50. We have 49% to 51%. 49% female to 51%. At the senior level, we have, at the management level, we have 40 to 60%. And at senior management level, senior and executive, we have 46 to 54%. Right, so it goes,
I see,
it's like this, it drops a bit and then it comes back up.
Yeah.
Right, and if I were to look at it, like I said, for jobs, now, if I were now to shine finer touch and look at, okay, yeah, I this is generic, by the time I start looking at different functions, remember when I was explaining the discrepancies, I packed aside one set of jobs. Jobs that are STEM jobs, to say, using my experience, there are some jobs that the problem starts from the beginning, to say, like in engineering, I was one girl to like 20 guys.
Mm-hmm.
I packed that aside. By the time you shine a touchlight into our 49 to 51%, which I think is not a bad idea, that's rounded up.
Of course.
49% female to 51% male. By the time you shine a touchlight and you look at, okay, the engineering team, what's the percentage? I'm not going to say what the percentage is here. But, generically, right, when you look at when you look at organizations that are not hugely STEM, you most times find 50-50%. But for us, it drops at management and then rises back up at senior management. And another reason why I'll say they're 50-50% is because at that junior level, the average age in Helium Health is around 26.
Yeah.
Between 24 and 26.
Yeah.
So there are a lot of young people. As I say, are coming out. We are looking for good people.
Of course. Of course.
I don't care what you look like. We're looking for good people. So we have an almost 50%. But as it grows, like I said, for some reason people leave. And I don't have enough data to say historically what has happened to the ladies that have left. We're pretty young, 5 years. If we had 15 years of data, I would have been able to say last 15 years, when people were exiting, what was their reason for exiting?
Yeah.
That's what would have given me a more informed decision to say, why is there a drop between the junior level and the management level. and all of that. But I think, as I said, it's consistent to say at the entry level, it's almost looking like 50-50% as it goes to management. So it's a little consistent, but the gap is not outrageous. Like I said, at the senior management level, it's 46% to 54% and all of that. So yeah, I think, so for the reason as to why, I'll say, just like I said, it's consistent with most of the reasons that I probably gave before to say that. There are also larger discussions to see if I were to put an X-ray into that figure and look at engineering team and things like that. It will bring up other things. Now, what are we doing? Again, like I said, from the entry level, I'm happy with the percentage to see. We are not looking at, that's 49-52, it's like 31-32. It's very close, right? We're not necessarily looking at, no, but just be good
at what you're doing, right?
And capable. I don't need to reduce the bar for women because they are
good,
at the enter. But what now happens, right, as you climb the ladder, as you stay in the organization, what happens to you? It's now the kind of policies you have, right? Because you know, you don't want to tell women that they can't go for maternity leave, right? What kind of maternity leave policies do you have? Mm-hmm. How does it affect them? So one of the things we're doing is to make sure we keep an eye on these figures, right? Especially when people are transiting from junior levels to management levels, right? To be sure that everybody's getting the same type of training, everybody's getting the same type of opportunities. And with the way work is now, there's remote work. Even if you, I tell people, I don't care if you stay on the moon. Because we have a remote first policy, just get the job done.
Correct.
So for me, that helps a lot with people who maybe need to relocate or anything, so that I don't lose good talent. So that's one of the ways. Another way is to say your maternity leave really shouldn't affect the work you do.
Yeah.
Right, in terms of promotion. So our promotion policy is you don't need one full year, you need 9 months. And let's say you even go on maternity leave that year. Maternity leave that year will not exceed 3 months. Yeah. Unless you choose to say you want to take a longer period. So it won't affect you. Because those are things that we should be mindful of. Especially if you've shown a trajectory of being a certain way. Because the 3 months you leave is not going to reduce. It's not going to minus what is in your brain. I don't want to lose you. Especially if we've been training you to be a good manager. So that's another thing we do. And then another thing that we're actively working towards doing. Can I say this here? So that people that want to come, we already, I'm not going to come and say that we don't have some crazy work days. Because if I lie, my people will drag
me.
Who are you talking about? So I can't lie. But it's something that we need to actively work towards, right? Mm-hmm. And like I said, I'm looking at a human being to say that, see, let's not deceive ourselves. And it's consistent with startups to say, in startups, right, you want one person to do 5 people's jobs. It's a natural thing. And you want them to do it now. And you want them to get it done with quality. You want it done yesterday. It's that crazy work that you get from startups that more structured or larger and bigger organizations use many people to solve. So it's another thing we're actively planning towards. So like last year, we did a lot of recruitments to say, let's start actively putting people in strategic positions.
Correct.
So that I keep telling people that one of the things I'm going to use to measure success, especially from HR, is the percentage of leave utilization. I need people to go on leave. I need people to be well rested. Another thing is things like training managers to reduce burnout in their teams. Don't look at me like that.
I was really keeping it in.
You see why I can't lie. You people start dragging me. But
go ahead.
To be honest, right? Those are things that, and you would have heard me say it on management group to say, don't burn out your people.
Yeah,
please don't kill my people for me, right? Good talent is not easy to find. I don't need people working crazy work. And I appreciate the fact that the world is beginning to know this. Because guess what? If I refuse to do it in the company, people that have better policies in their company will poach my talent because
they will give them good
work.
Of course.
Do you understand? They give them better working conditions.
Yes.
So another thing we've done is we have flexible work. Like I said, be on the moon.
Yeah.
Do your work. So,
I mean, I can totally testify to you, Ijeoma. I can testify to it. I mean, if I start to tell you the stories of misogyny that I've experienced in the past, but I mean, here I'm just like, you know, nobody.
You're boiling now.
You know, nobody interrupts me. Me too. I'm a girl and I'm a baby girl. You know, I'm a baby girl.
So, I mean, people are like looking at me side eye, like, what is she talking about? Well, yeah, but that's the truth.
And it's important.
Yeah.
To me, because it's important. It helps me attract the right type
correct,
of people.
Correct.
It helps me keep people right. I've heard someone say this before in this company, and I was happy when I heard her say that. One of the reasons why I'm staying is because it's favorable for me and my child, right? I still get to spend time
correct.
With my child because I'm
correct.
Working from home, right?
Yes.
And I was happy when I heard that because I don't need people. I've been in organizations where somebody ran to HR when she got pregnant, panicking because she was afraid that she was going to lose her job.
Oh.
Right? And
yeah, I can get that toxic. Yes. Yes.
And the funniest thing about it was we showed her the policy that, my dear, there's nobody can, you get maternity leave, you're not going to get fired. She said, leave the policy. What we have seen in this
reality.
Company for the
mm-hmm.
past
mm-hmm.
couple of years is that the moment you get pregnant, within how many months you get fired. And then we now have to start actively fighting that. Yeah. So when somebody tells me that she's happy being here because it allows her to be with her child and she's still able to do her job, and the output of that person, like I said, we need to look at results. The output of that person did not drop, right, because she had a child, right? So there's all those funny things that might have in the past formed people's biases. There's no need for that because this person I'm talking about does remarkably well at her job. But she's happy that she still has time for her. Then I know
yeah.
that I've done my work.
You know?
yeah,
so everybody, the theme of this year's International Women's Day is choose to challenge. So yeah, I challenge you today to choose to challenge every stereotype. Why do I feel like I'm like in like a deliverance session? Because I'm really shaking my body. Any stereotype, any bias that you see that can, you know, hinder your, an inclusive workplace,
yeah.
to be honest. And then, like Ijeoma said, the outcome will speak for themselves, to be honest. You see it yourself. The results will show. Right? Let's encourage diversity and let's just be, yeah. yeah, celebrate women. Men, celebrate women. Right? This is not a program for women by women. Right. Yeah, so I think it's a wrap, is it? It's a wrap. I've had fun. Ijeoma, have you had fun?
Well, I
can you
have.
See the gray hair popping out of my, can you see it? Because
I
of Ijeoma, she just passed on some wisdom,
mm.
right? So I'm like, yes, it's a wrap. And enjoy the rest of your day. Bye.